Glad that you have chosen to come and worship with us here at Pleasant Hill Community Church of the United Church of Christ. And we welcome our friends that are coming through us through our multimedia, Facebook and YouTube and all kinds of things. We're glad you have come within our sacred walls to join us in worship. I want to thank you for the time away to be with my family. I have a new fashion statement. If you can't see, I have an original artwork done by my 2.5-year-old grandchild who lets me know what my name is. So it's important. So I wear that in honor of my Katie Grace. But thank you for people who volunteered to tend to things here. We are coming up. We're going to have a Blue Christmas service on Tuesday afternoon at 4 o'clock here in the sanctuary. I do something a little different. It's all done in PowerPoint. It's a gift that I give to my musicians over the years, because adding one more service through the holidays is a little, you know. And so, yeah, she goes, nah, you know, add one more in there. But it'll be a series of music, but not live music. And it's traditionally somewhere between 35 and 40 minutes long. So our friends over at Fletcher House, you'll be in time for supper then. But I want to be sure you know about that. So I had the privilege of going to the Blue Barn, and I found this nativity set. And I assume it's somewhere in Africa, and if anybody knows anything about this nativity set, let me know. I would love to know which country it came from, the story behind it, but I've added that to my collection, and it's pretty neat. So if you know anything, let me know. The last thing to tell you about is on Facebook, there is a series called The Wandering Wise Men. and it is fun. And if you have children, grandchildren, or even yourself, you can have a lot of fun each day from now until the Epiphany. They will have these characters trying to get themselves to Bethlehem. And it is hilarious, it's fun, and this is today's, but you can go through Facebook, just put in Wondering Wise Men, and you'll have a good chuckle throughout the season to prepare yourselves for the season. So let's wave and pass the peace to our brothers and sisters, siblings here in the space. We're glad that you were here. And then we're going to hear the bell, and then I'm going to invite you a special invitation to this worship. A long time ago, I left the Baptist tradition and I went to work at the Episcopal Church in Asheville, North Carolina, in downtown Trinity. I started on November the 1st. And so it was a good experience. In fact, part of my experience there was that I got to meet a well-trained intentional interim. Bill Todd was the rector, interim rector of the church, and he wanted this crazy idea to see if a Baptist educator could help improve education in an Episcopal church. So I got to have a lot of fun there. But during the first few days of there in November, I'll never forget Bill Todd coming to my doorway. Now, Bill was like 6'2 or 6'3. And he was standing at my doorway and he says, "I want you to know this. We in the Episcopal Church do not play Christmas music until the sun sets on the 24th. You cannot have any Christmas music in your office until the sun sets." Now, I looked over at my brand new CD player. I couldn't play my music. So I tried it that year. I didn't even listen to Christmas music at home. Well, the season that we're investing in Advent is called the Songs of Christmas. Raymond Brown, a theologian, wrote a massive commentary on Luke. And in it, he talks about there are four songs that Luke had to put in the story of the birth of Jesus, the birth narratives. And in those, he said, you know the realization? You can't tell the story without singing. So how is your music this season going to be? What is your song this season? So I invite you as we come to explore these stories and see if we find ourselves, enrich ourselves, and draw closer to that manger. That's your invitation.
These are days of struggle for people at home and around the world. Employment is uncertain, money is tight, health challenges abound, and health care costs are expensive. War has gone on for a long, long time. Even our Earth home suffers from long abuse. Anxiety is a constant companion. Hope feels we call out in our anxiety, show us how you work, God. School us in your ways. Take us by the hand. Lead us down the path of well-being. You are our Savior, aren't you? Mark the milestones of your mercy and love, God. We remind ourselves of God's ancient promises. Justice is coming. Love is on the way. Lift up your heads and watch for the signs. Let us light this first candle of Advent, a candle of hope. In its light, let us think about what signs we are seeing of God at work in our lives and in our world right now. Let this candle of Advent hope shine in our hearts all week and remind us to lift up our heads and open our eyes to watch all around for the signs of the Holy One. Source of all we hope and desire, we stand on the edge of a new year in the church, which begins with an age-old story of longing and waiting, promise and fulfillment, newness and possibility. Yet we are often harried, hurried, busy, and worried. Longing to spend time with you are set aside. Drowned out by the consumer ads for a new and improved, supersized life. Our vision can be obscured by to-do list, too busy to see the signs of your presence. We confess those times when we have not paid attention to the groaning of our planet and sighs of the murmurs of our new people. We have not paid attention to you. We are listening now. Help us to hear your call. We are watching now. Help us to see as we turn ourselves back to your ways.
It's patiently waiting for us to open up our eyes and open our ears to hear the good news that we are loved and forgiven. Amen.
As we sing our song in the night.
announcement this afternoon at 3 o'clock. I'm going to be showing the documentary 1946 about the mistranslation of a word that changed a culture. And I hope that you will be wanting to come, and we'll be doing it here in this space and in, hopefully enlighten. So I have a tradition of reading children's books during Advent because I love children's books. So I share you my favorite of all of them, The Christmas Miracle of Jonathan Toomey. The village children called him Mr. Gloomy, but in fact his name was Mr. Toomey, Mr. Jonathan Toomey, and though it's not kind to call people names, this one fit quite well. For Jonathan Toomey seldom smiled, and he never laughed. He went about mumbling and grumbling and muttering and sputtering, grumpy and griping. He complained that the church bells rang too often and the birds sang too shrilly and the children played way too loudly. Mr. Toomey was a wood carver. Some said he was the best wood carver in the whole valley. He spent his days sitting at his workbench carving beautiful shapes from blocks of pine or hickory or chestnut wood. After supper, he would sit in his straight-backed chair near the fireplace, smoking his pipe and staring into the flames. Jonathan Toomey wasn't an old man, but if you saw him, you might think he was. The way he walked bent forward and his head down. You wouldn't notice his eyes of clear blue like an August sky, and you wouldn't see the dimple in his chin, since his face was mostly hidden under a shaggy, untrimmed beard, speckled with sawdust and wood shavings and, depending on what he ate that day, crumbs of bread and a bit of potato and dried gravy. The village people didn't know it, but there was a reason for his gloom, a reason for his grumbling, a reason why he walked hunched over as he carried a great weight on his shoulders. See, some years earlier, when Jonathan Toomey was young and full of life and full of love, his wife and baby had become sick. And because those were the days before hospitals and medicines and skilled doctors, his wife and baby died 3 days apart from each other. So Jonathan Toomey had packed his belongings into a wagon and traveled until his tears stopped. He settled into a tiny house at the edge of the village to do his woodworking. Now, one day in December, there was a knock at Jonathan's door. Mumbling and grumbling, he went to answer it, and there stood a woman and a young boy. "I'm the widow McDowell. I'm new in the village. This is my son Thomas," the woman said. "I'm 7 and I know how to whistle," said Thomas. "Whistling is pish-posh," said the wood carver gruffly. "I need something carved," said the woman, and she told Jonathan about a very special set of Christmas figures her grandfather had carved for her when she was a girl. "After I moved here, I discovered that they were lost," she explained. "I had hoped by some miracle I would find them again, but it hasn't happened." "There is no such thing as a miracle," the wood carver told her. "Now, can you describe the figures for me?" "There were sheep," she told him. "2 of them with curly wool," said Thomas. "Yes, 2, said the widow, "and a cow and an angel, Mary, Joseph, the baby Jesus, and the wise men." "3 of them," added Thomas. "Will you take the job?" asked Widow McDowell. I will. I'm grateful. How soon can they be ready? They'll be ready when they're ready, he said. But I've got to have them for Christmas. They mean so much to me. I can't remember a Christmas without them. Christmas is pish posh! And he slammed the door. Well, guess what? You got to come back next week. Well, we come to our time as we gather as a community. Of course, you can look at the back of our prayer list, or those online can look through Realm. Our many prayer concerns. I do have a little update with Ted McKnight. Ted is gaining strength, and he's praying and ask us to pray for him as he tries to get strength back and be more restored to health. He did have his children home for Thanksgiving, which was really important. In fact, the whole family, Marty included, got to have a little field trip out, which was really good for them. Also learned on Friday night that Sam Hahn has lost one of her sisters. And if I'm right, you have 10 sisters? 10 siblings? 10 siblings. But this is the first in her family that she lost, and she lived in Missouri. So we lift up Sam at this time. Also, if you don't know yet, John Hoover, who's a member of the Upland Village, he passed away on Friday morning, or at some time that he was discovered on Friday. But we want to remember his family, and especially his friends that really tended to him and their small community faith, or community of George and Ron, thank you.
Cindy Stoller.
Oh, okay, yes, across the street. Yes, thank you. But we want to be aware of that, and I talked to George, and George says, there will be a party to celebrate his life. I said, all right, so appropriate. But those are our concerns that we have, and so let us at this time come to a time of prayer. Let us pray. Our most gracious and loving God, we are truly thankful that we have come through this season of Thanksgiving, and for some of us it was time to be with family and friends for food and celebration, and for some it was memories of years gone past. But we are thankful that we have this season, but also that we can live a life of thanksgiving. And now we come to a season of Advent, of waiting and watching, renewal of our faith. And so we ask that you help us in that journey. Of course, we have concerns that are happening around us, our community, the concerns of illness, death, that we face, and let us find ways that we can reach out to one another and give support to each other during these days. God, we are asked to call and to pray for people that are in leadership. So we pray for people in our community and in our state and in our nation and throughout the world. People who make decisions of great power, we call for them to be people that look for the least of these, the vulnerable ones, the call for justice. And so we call and be people of mercy and justice too. So God, we ask that you watch over us as a community. We ask that you watch over Joy Lynn as she's finishing her time there and then preparation of coming to here to be the next leader of this church. So we ask and pray these things through your Son, who taught us so many things about life and living and interacting with one another. So we say the prayer that he taught us to say our mother, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The magnificence of cats. Isn't that what Magnificat means? I mean, cats are important. Here's Desmond, my first of my grandcats. That's Desmond, that's my oldest daughter's cat. And then here's Ollie, my other grandcat, and she even allowed me to rub her head while I was visiting at her home, and then she hissed at me. And then there it is, the infamous Snowflake, my cat. You notice her blue and green eyes. She is full of it, to say the least. But those are the cats. But really, there's something more than that, the Magnificat. It's really what do we do, It's what do we do with Mary? Here, our first song that we hear is the song that in Latin says Magnificat, I magnify the Lord. And so we call it by that, but it's the song of Mary. Now, okay, I'm a Protestant kid, born, raised in every way, form, or shape. So I never really knew what to do with Mary growing up. You know, that was them Catholic things, you know. Y'all know about the Catholic things, you know. But, so I didn't know, but I always remember going to visit my grandmother. And in her living room, she had a planter vase that was in the shape of Mary. It was this beautiful piece. In fact, I got it. I wanted it because it meant something to me to see that always in my grandmother's house. And I mean, this woman was a teetotaling Baptist to the hilt. But for some reason, she had that, and she also had a very tall, slender piece of the Madonna symbol in her collection. But see, I've always wondered, what do we do with her? Well, some people have suggested that she symbolizes or represents the feminine side of God. Now, of course, what do you expect when we have a faith community that is so driven by men having controls? They'd made all the decisions. They're going like, what am I supposed to do? I mean, since I am a man, I don't fully understand, but I have a deep suspicion that I can understand what women were thinking. They were like, well, wait a minute. Where's the more gentle side about God? And so Mary sort of became that symbol in it. But it's so interesting that when Mary was confronted, when Gabriel showed up at the house to tell her, you're going to be carrying the child of God. And so it's interesting that always when God is breaking into history and into life, there always begins with the same words, do not be afraid. God is about to do something. And so Mary becomes that receptacle about allowing God to do something. See, I love this moment in the liturgical cycle because our hearts and thoughts are with Mary, the unwed teenager, chosen to give birth to the Christ child. Now, a few years ago, in fact, 6 years ago, during this season, I was like, this is the first time I really could sort of get into Advent because I had my first grandchild on the way. Originally, it was supposed to come on December the 23rd. It ended up coming in on December the 15th. But during that Advent season, I thought, oh my gosh, what was it to be like to be a young woman who was not of the norm of the time experiencing? Yolanda Pierce goes on to write, "I cannot understand Advent apart from the Mary story. Did she experience joyous expectation at the news of her pregnancy? Did she fear the social ostracism connected with her unwed and pregnant state? She could have been stoned, and it would have been biblical that that could have happened to her. Luckily, she had a fiancé who stepped up and said, wait a minute, and protected her. Did she lie awake at night and wonder about the path her child would walk? How did Mary deal with the daily dance between an all-consuming love for her child and the all-consuming fear of the world into which her child would be born?" I don't know about you, but I've even had to be that way with the birth of my own children and my grandchildren. What are they being born into? Well, after she is given the announcement, she bursts forth into the Magnificat, the song of Mary. It ends up being in two parts. The first part is really a praise about God. Who is this God? And she is what God is doing. And the second part is what God is going to do for Israel, for the community of faith. See, her exaltation of what God is doing for her, she's bursting with good news. "I'm dancing with the song of my Savior. God took one good look at me, and look what happened. I'm the most fortunate woman on the earth. What God has done for me will never be forgotten. The God who is your very name is holy, set apart from all the others." We have a deep suspicion that she was a young child, probably just in her early teen years. To think about what it meant to have this kind of news in your life. Do you notice that in the scriptures that Mary does not say she's not worthy? She doesn't question that. She just asks for a clarification. She only asks how she can become, she only asks how. She becomes the archetype of a perfect receptivity about welcoming what God wants to do. Brian Tracy says, "The person we believe ourselves to be will always act in a manner consistent with our self-image." I don't know about you, but I'm not sure when I looked in the mirror, I would see that. But it is our self-image about how we see ourselves is so important. And Mary really must have had something around her that really helped her to face what was coming her way. So often we become like this image, so fractured in our lives that we really don't recognize who we are or really who we belong to. Richard Rohr writes, "We don't really believe that God could naturally know and love what God has created, or that we could actually love or even like God back." See, the psalmist knew and told us, "For we are created in the innermost being. We are knitted together in our mother's womb. We are special from the very beginning." Now, the second part of the song is what God is doing for Israel. Listen, it says, "His mercy flows in wave after wave on those who are in awe before Him. He bares His arm and shows His strength and scatters the bluffing braggarts. He knocks tyrants off their high horses, and he pulls victims out of the mud. The starving poor sat down to a banquet. The callous rich were left out in the cold. He embraces the chosen child, Israel. He remembers and piles on the mercy, piles them on high, exactly what he promised, beginning with Abraham, even to this moment. Think about what she says. What she sings is really about an upside down world. To look at things differently. You take the image and just flip it. That's what she was offering to us. So let's look again. See, she says, he has scattered those who were proud and thought of their hearts. People who think they're bigger, more powerful than anything else. She goes on to sing, he has brought down the rulers from their thrones and exalted those who were mighty. But then comes the great blessing. He has fulfilled the hungry with good things. Those who are not important, supposedly, who are left out, they're going to have a good meal, a good celebration, and sent away the rich empty-handed. He has given help to Israel, his servant. So what does this say to us? I think there are three things, and I'm going to add a fourth, that we need a better understanding about how God sees us. I don't know about you, but I at times have a rough time thinking that I'm really of worth, that I am not what God has created. And understand that God has made a good and perfect thing. We also need to see God's vision with an upside down eyes from the most of us are taught. God is always asking us, as I love to say, as Ken Miedema says in his song, learning to fly upside down. Seeing things differently. God's ways are not the ways of the empire, not the ways of power. It is always the way of the least. And we need to be willing to realize that God speaks in the most unlikely ways. God is always speaking and giving to us. Early this morning, my typical Sunday morning, I woke up early. And I was sitting there and thinking about, A, what day it is. You know how this week is with Thanksgiving, throws everything off. What day of the week is this? I went, oh, it's Sunday. Oh, I got to preach about Mary. And I started thinking, now, what I'm about to say, I'll be happy to have a good discussion with any of you in this room about what I'm about to say. Could this song that Mary proclaims at the announcement was also the song that she cuddled and nourished and loved her child? Did she keep singing this song? See, for somehow, I think this song greatly influenced who Jesus became. Jesus came to upset the system, change things in a different direction, learning to fly upside down. He became, in my opinion, the song. And God, I am thankful he did. Amen.
A question we might ask ourselves is, how is God at work in our life, in your life, in my life? What are you prepared to give so that others can have hope? Our offerings are tangible expressions of the hope we are willing to share. So at this time, I would remind you that if you're here in the sanctuary, you know that we have plate here on the table and at each entrance. But if you're worshiping with us online, then I invite you to go to our website, pleasanthillucctn.org, and you'll find a tab for giving there. So let us think about, what have we to give, what have we to share, as we listen to the offertory. Won't you pray with me? Dear Lord, we offer these gifts to you with deep gratitude for your unfailing care for us. May they help others find hope and joy, peace and confidence in your love for them and all creation. Amen.
Be seated. Our benediction is this, that we are to sing a song of God's praise, for God does great and marvelous things in all of us. And then we need to keep our eye out for those who are on the margin, the least of these, and find ways to be God's agent. Amen.
Wanted the choir members to know about it. Thank you.